Good morning, this is Brent with Lycus Motorsports, and we're going to go over the next build that we have. I've got a handful of big cubic inch engines, FEs, coming through the shop. Probably got four or five, 496, 505, somewhere around that cubic inch range. We were working on one, and the owner decided to, he wanted me to ship the block and the heads and the intake and everything to him so he could mock it up in his car before the final body work and paint was done. We have everything here to assemble that engine, but the body work is gonna be taking a while, so we got that one temporarily on hold. The next one in the queue is a 496 cubic inch FE based off of a BBM block, and it's a forced induction build using a centrifugal supercharger. So I wanted to go over the foundation for this build, and we're going to do some preliminary checking and measuring this weekend as the block is being cleaned and machined. The cylinder heads we're going to use are these BBM heads. We had these ported, and these are around the 320-330 CFM range, I think, right now. I have to look back at the sheet, but they are fully assembled, set up for a solid roller. You can see how it's been milled for the TND paired rocker system, since we're using an aluminum head and a solid roller camshaft. But these have been fitted with some Manly springs and titanium retainers. Really nice parts. The crankshaft is this SCAT forged steel 4 1/4 stroke. We're gonna be fitting up the rest of the rotating assembly with these K1 rods. Very stout, but also on the lighter side of things in comparison to some of the other connecting rods that are out there. The pistons are these fully custom diamond pistons. They have been coated on the crowns with a ceramic coating for the forced induction application. They are using some Total Seal AP steel rings, and we're using some Trend tool steel wrist pins. So everything in this engine is built for high horsepower with some boost. So I think we're gonna be running somewhere around the 12, 13, 14 pounds of boost range, and we're setting up the bottom end for that. So we're going to go ahead and I'm going to unbox all the pistons and all the rods. We're going to get everything washed, measure the pistons and weigh them, check our rod bearing clearances since we have the crankshaft here. We're going to be using some calico coated Clevite rod bearings, and we're going to get all this weighed and matched up and pistons hung on the rods and get some assembly going. All right, so we fast forwarded a little bit. We got all of our parts washed, got all of our pistons cleaned and ready to go. As I mentioned, these are ceramic coated on the crowns. That is meant to reflect the heat back up into the combustion chamber, and that's really important on forced induction applications. It keeps the heat away from the piston so that the piston doesn't experience any bad things due to excessive heat in the combustion chamber or in the combustion process. So we got all of those washed and cleaned. Got all of our K1 rods washed and cleaned. These are Trend tool steel wrist pins, and you will probably look at these and say those look heavy, and they are heavy. We're expecting to make a good bit of horsepower. We do not want any deflection in the wrist pin. Deflection in the wrist pin can cause damage inside of the piston. We don't want that. Got all of our spiral locks. We needed 32. They sent 33. That's why I count everything ahead of time so that I don't get all the pistons assembled and think, uh-oh, which one did I skip a spiral lock on? So I counted those twice. Oil support rails have been washed. So obviously we can't do anything with our piston rings yet because the block is not finished, but I will use those for weighing. We're going to get a we're going to weigh everything and get our bob weight so that we can have our crank balanced. So the order of process this morning, we're going to measure our pistons on the skirt diameter, make sure that they're all where they need to be. We're going to weigh our pistons. We're going to weigh our rods on a rod scale, weigh all of our other components. And then once we get our bob weight, then we're going to assemble the pistons on the rods, and we're going to check our bearing clearances using our coated rod bearings. So with forced induction and higher horsepower applications, we do things a little bit differently. You will see me increase the bearing clearances a little bit. Even though we have a 4340 steel crankshaft, under a lot of pressure and a lot of horsepower, crankshafts can deflect a little bit, and we don't want to pinch a bearing. So you will see me increase the bearing clearances a little bit. Ring gaps on our piston rings will increase as well with the extra amount of heat inside the combustion chamber and on the top of that piston. We don't want that ring to close up and touch. So you will see me add a little bit more of ring end gap so that it doesn't happen. After some careful measuring, we have weights and dimensions on our pistons. The engine is going to be a 4310 bore, and our piston diameters are about 304.5. So we've got about 5.5 thousandths of piston to cylinder clearance. And that may sound like a little bit, but these are 2618 forgings, so they expand more than a 4032 aluminum will. Plus, we have to remember that we're going to be putting more heat into the engine. So we want lots of, a little bit more room than normal for your piston to grow. Weights vary, and that's normal. I mean, we're just looking even between these two rods, the big end 517.2, 514.5, little ends 227.4, 225.8. That's normal. Pistons will vary, and that's normal. When you get that big chunk of aluminum, you'll see a little bit of difference there. But you can grind and you can drill until you get them all even. My preferred way of weight matching is to, before the bearing clearances are checked and everything, just to lay out pistons in order from light to heavy, and the rod little ends from light to heavy, and just try to pair parts up, because I have weighed everything and I've gotten an average of the weights. And I'm gonna try to get to that average because my bob weight's gonna be based off of that average. So we're gonna try to weight match everything, pair it up so that we don't have to grind, we don't have to drill and that sort of thing. So that'll take me probably close to 30, 40 minutes to get that done. I'm not gonna bore you with that, but when I get everything balanced up, then I'll get back with you and we'll get pistons hung on the rods. All right, so we got parts shuffled around and measured and weighed, and I've got things well under a gram difference, and that is tighter than good. Considering you have oil splashing around, you can't control the equal amount of oil that you get on each piston and rod assembly. So if you're under a gram, at a gram or a little bit under, then you're fine. So I just try to be as careful as I can when pairing things up so I don't have to drill or grind or anything like that. But we're in good shape. I've got everything marked. Let's see, 1 and 5. I got them opposite of each other. So now I'll be hanging the pistons on the rods.
All right, what I usually do is put the spiral locks in on one side, and then get everything ready on the other side. I stick my finger in between and get it started. These pistons are really deep because they're not like an inboard pin boss. They're almost a full round for strength. But it's good to have a dedicated screwdriver for that. And if you spread the spiral lock apart just a little bit and stick your finger in there, then you can, the key is to keep it stretched out a little bit. And the more that you keep it stretched out, you can walk it around. On smaller pistons where you don't have this full round shape or whatever, it's a little bit easier to get down in there. But got that one side. I'm gonna grab some oil and I'll be right back with you. All right, so we're gonna put, this is just some heavy 50 weight oil that I use for assembly. Lube up wrist pin. Make sure that the chamfer on the rod big end faces to your right on forward. And I had these pin fit at diamond for a little extra clearance, and they just slide right in like butter. And then you put, same deal, put your spiral locks in. Sometimes you can almost stretch them out with your finger. Although this one's fighting me. Probably because I can hear a phone conversation in the other room and it's distracting me. Click. One done. We'll do the other seven. And we are all mounted up. Pistons are on rods. Support rails are on. So next step is to check our bearing clearances. And we'll start with one just to make sure that got the right bearings, and we'll go from there. But when I get my bore gauge out and zero my micrometer and set my bore gauge to it, and we'll check bearing clearances here. These are K1 rods, and they use a torque angle, 30 pound feet. I'll have to measure the rod bolt and double check on which one that we're going to be at. I think we're going to be at this 30 pound feet plus 60 degrees, but I'll check and make sure. But that'll be our torque spec, and we'll get our bearing clearances checked. All right, so the first rod clearance was checked. I was at 0032 with X bearings, and I like a little bit of extra clearance. I don't like that much. Typically run on a street engine, on a hot street engine, somewhere around the 2.2 to 2.5 mark. I want a little bit extra clearance for any deflection that may be going on. But 3,000s, a little bit over, was too loose. So I mixed an X bearing and a standard bearing and got 0.028. And I like where that is, based off of past clearances and checking things when they come back in. So I'm gonna get that done. The bad news is that I only had one pair of standard bearings. So I'm going to get the number one rod done and the number five rod done since they're on the same journal. And then I'm going to order more bearings. So that's where we are, and that's where we're going to be. I'm going to go ahead and get the crank dropped off to be balanced since I have my bob weight. And we'll check bearing clearances probably beginning of next week when the bearings come in. But we're off to a good start. And just as a recap, this is going to be a BBM block 4310 bore with a 4 1/4 stroke. So we're at 496 cubic inches. Ported BBM cylinder heads. Got a really nice ported Victor FE intake manifold to go with it. And gonna mount a hairdryer to the front of this thing. So we're gonna be looking for some good horsepower. We've got excellent, excellent parts in the bottom end. Our customer, Mr. Steve, has spared little expense on putting good parts in the bottom. So that's where the foundation of the engine always is in the machine work and the rotating assembly. And then whatever you bolt on to the top is just added bonus. But we're off to a good start. Hopefully the block will be finished up maybe the end of next week. And then we can start on some other things. But appreciate you all sticking with me and watching. And stay tuned for some updates to this build. Got a lot more cool stuff coming through. So make sure you hit that subscribe button. And that you don't miss out on anything. I know a lot of you have picked up on some of the past videos where we've done a guess the horsepower, but apparently you're not subscribers because you're always commenting saying what happened. So make sure you hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out. All right, this is Brent, Likens Motorsports. Y'all have a good weekend.